News of the speed at which Lusitania sank and survivors' accounts of a second explosion following the torpedo were used to justify Germany's claim that Lusitania was carrying munitions destined for Britain.
I don't think there's any doubt that she was carrying a certain limited amount of ammunition, but nothing that would have caused the huge explosion that did occur.
In 1993, after nearly 80 years of controversy, Dr. Robert Ballant, discoverer of the Titanic, led an expedition to the wreck of the Lusitania in an attempt to discover the reason for the second explosion. Was Lusitania carrying explosives as Germany claimed? Or was there another explanation? Rather than contraband, Ballard found evidence to suggest that the torpedo hit a nearly empty fuel bunker, igniting highly combustible coal dust.
So I think Ballard has got it about right, and that it was a secondary explosion of a mixture of coal dust which blew the side out of the ship, and that's why she went down so quickly.
Both sides used the incident for propaganda at home and abroad. A medal struck in Germany celebrating the sinking of the so-called blockade runner created furor in Britain. Meanwhile, movie cameras captured Lusitania's final moments on a duck pond on London's Wimbledon Common. Presented in newsreel cinemas as actual footage of the disaster, the film was designed to fuel international hatred of Germany. Winston Churchill seemed to be looking for just such an incident. In top-secret correspondence written months earlier, Churchill stressed the importance of attracting neutral shipping to British shores in hopes of drawing the U.S. into the war with Germany. He stressed Britain's need for the ocean trade. The more, the better, he said. But if some of it gets into trouble, better still. Churchill's macabre wish came true, but at the cost of nearly 1,200 innocent lives. For its part, Germany had unwittingly fallen into Churchill's trap and offered the world its first terrible vision of absolute war.
And that, in a sense, set the tone for the world that after 100 years almost of the Congress of Vienna to the sinking of the Lusitania, that civilians were not safe. There was no respect for civilian traffic as opposed to naval or war traffic.
The sinking of Lusitania dramatically changed United States opinions toward Germany, but isolationist sentiment won out. President Wilson refrained from declaring war. Instead, he sent a damning protest to the Kaiser, warning that the U.S. would not tolerate further incidents. American passenger ships would now sail the Atlantic with guns mounted to fend off any overzealous U-boat captain. But the attacks continued. And every American ship that limped into port holed by torpedoes or wrecked by gunfire further pressured the president. Finally, on April 6, 1917, after 2 years of provocation, the United States Congress voted to declare war on Germany. Across America, young men rallied to the call to arms. The American Expeditionary Force would offer a fresh vitality to the exhausted Allied battalions bogged down in the mud and misery of Europe. But how to get them there? The answer? Dozens of German passenger liners tied up in U.S. ports. All German liners were immediately interned at the declaration of war. Now, they were to be transformed from passenger ships to American troop ships. In some cases, German crews scuttled or sabotaged their ships rather than give their new enemy an advantage. To clear a path for transports on the Atlantic, U.S. and British submarine chasers and blimps made an all-out assault on the elusive German U-boats.
Along the eastern seaboard of America, bound for France, were shiploads of troops fresh to war and high in morale. Men full of confidence and the "we'll soon finish this off" kind of spirit.
When crowds at a French port cheered the arrival of General Pershing, the American commander-in-chief, the Germans could no longer boast that no American soldier would ever set foot on the soil of Europe. For now the first were setting foot, and so were thousands more of his fellow countrymen.
Over the coming months, nearly 2 million soldiers would cross the perilous Atlantic on converted liners. It was the largest seaborne transportation of troops in history, and certainly the most dangerous. By the summer of 1918, American soldiers had joined a massive counteroffensive that would bring an end to the war.
In the Argonne, the Stars and Stripes rose from the ground, and the promise behind all that training and build-up of American strength was fulfilled. So then it was British, French, American, Australian, New Zealand, Canadian, and South African together sweeping the gray from the field.
Finally, on November 11th, 1918, the battlefields of Europe fell silent for the first time in 4 years. At war's end, hundreds of overcrowded troopers and hospital ships journeyed home. The Atlantic crossing of a week or two was bearable. But for Australian and New Zealand troops, the two-month voyage left many wondering if they'd ever reach home at all. Homecomings in New York drew enormous crowds. The ex-German liner Vaterland, renamed Leviathan, had transported over 110,000 troops to Europe. On one extraordinary crossing, she carried more than 14,000 people. At that time, the greatest number of passengers to travel on one ship ever recorded. The liners made a tremendous impact in the war to end all wars. Their capacity to move entire armies from continent to continent was instrumental in globalizing the war and shifting the balance of power to the Allies. In 1919, the victors met in Paris to decide on the fate of Germany. With 13 million tons of Allied merchant shipping lost, now was the time to settle the score. The three giants of the Hamburg-America line were awarded to their American and British competitors. Cunard received Imperator and renamed her Berengaria. Leviathan went into service for the United States line. And the world's largest liner, Bismarck, was taken over by the White Star Line and renamed Majestic. Albert Ballin, the director of the Hamburg-America line, as if foreseeing the inevitable loss of his great fleet, took an overdose of sleeping pills 2 days before the armistice. From the devastation of war, old wounds resurfaced. A tidal wave of refugees, many facing political and religious persecution, went in search of a new life in other lands. Hopeful immigrants took one-way passage on steamers bound for Canada, South America, Australia, and New Zealand. But For the overwhelming majority, the destination was America.
We left from Hamburg. Ship's name was Reliance.
The name of the ship was the SS Zabland.
And I think it was called the Cameronia.
In the early post-war years, as many as 30,000 immigrants crossed the Atlantic by liner each week.
I remember hordes of people. There were more people on that boat than I thought.
There was six of us. Seven. Six children and my mother. We're all in one room.
We lived in the lowest part of the ship, and the whole way down the hold on three-tier high beds. In the first two or three days, whoever was on the bottom was out of luck.
My mother and my sister and I were seasick all the 3 weeks we were on that boat.
The food was excellent. It was good food.
The food was horrible. As I know, my mother was a terrific cook. But as far as I was concerned, it was a part of like adventure, especially when during the day when you went up the steps and went out on the deck and looked out and saw that big expanse of ocean. It was impressive.
Everybody got excited when you could see the skyline. All the people rushed up on deck, but we felt that the ship was going to roll over because all the passengers were on one side of the ship. But it was just fabulous. We were all waiting for the moment to see the Statue of Liberty because that was a sign we are now here.
Immigrants traveling in first and second class were processed by officials on board and disembarked at the shipping line's terminal. But for passengers in steerage, the journey was far from over. They were ferried to Ellis Island in the shadow of the Statue of Liberty. With its grandiose architecture, Ellis Island represented a gateway of both hope and fear for the immigrants. Here they would face hours, sometimes even days, of rigorous processing and questioning.
There was one large room. We were all in one large room. And I remember, first of all, they took all our clothing and washed it and cleaned it. And we had a chance to shower and clean ourselves. And we had the physical examinations.
For all new arrivals, there is a medical examination to weed out those with serious illnesses and dangerous diseases.
The real concern was, my mother said, if you go when you come to the, we're coming to the medical department. When you get to the medical department, don't cough or anything like that.
And being examined, especially my hair, they were very careful about not letting people in with lice.
Many immigrants were detained at the island's hospital for weeks and months at a time, the cost of which was borne by the shipping lines. Anyone ruled physically or mentally unfit would be sent back to the line for deportation.
I was pulled out on a physical, and we had to stay an extra night. Overnight, I had to be re-examined. And I was just fearful that I would be sent back. To this day, I always feel that if it was up to that, I would have gone back. My family would have stayed here. And that was my fear. I was 11 years old.
People turned away and were walking away crying bitter tears, but it obviously didn't help them because they walked away with an officer with them. And we were allowed to go through this door and they had to go through that door.
Today, more than one in three Americans can trace their ancestry to that first, often fearful step onto American soil at Ellis Island and that unforgettable passage by ocean liner.
In earlier years, up until the early 20s, 18 million people came across the Atlantic, all of them by sea, and most of them stopping at Ellis Island as part of the Great Process. It was the greatest movement the world has ever seen of people from one continent to another, from the old world to the new.
You know, the creation of the American dream. And without the big superliners, there wouldn't have been any American dream.
I don't think I'll ever forget it, because that was one of the most important aspects of my life, being aboard ship and knowing my destination. We look forward to being Americans.
Among the lucky people, I was one of the luckiest. Freedom. Opportunity, freedom, which encompasses every possible definition of that word.
I reflect upon it all the time, because to us, it was a matter of life or death. Because all my mother's family, and there must have been over 100 people in that small town, they all perished. And we lived because of that journey.
Vessels of the Sea is sponsored in part by Tylenol, the pain reliever hospitals use most.
According to F. Scott Fitzgerald, by the 1920s, all gods were dead, all wars were fought, and all faiths shaken. The post-war world was going to be different, and how. But front row center on the American political stage were two new laws that threatened the future of the big transatlantic liners. A bill called the Emergency Quota Act finally pulled down the curtain on unrestricted immigration to the United States, and prohibition outlawed the manufacturing and sale of alcohol across the country.
That meant American liners could not offer one of the most wonderful aspects of an ocean voyage, the long bars, you know, that little nip in the morning and the little nip after lunch and the brandies and all that kind of stuff. So the foreign lines really were able to capitalize on this.
To break the alcoholic embargo, some American lines registered their ships elsewhere and capitalized on the public's thirst by offering booze cruises to nowhere. Then, a number of enterprising passenger agents came up with a novel idea at the same time. Tourism. Aimed at middle-class Americans, particularly the adventurous set, smaller ships would set sail to some exotic destination and back for no other purpose than to have a good time. Until the 1920s, there was no better place to see the class system at work than on an ocean liner. But now, the age of mass tourism was here, and ship life became a democracy of romance and pleasure where no one was better than anyone else. The grand experiment would have a revolutionary outcome. The one-class ship. According to a New York Times critic, the new trend spelled the end of the class system on the high seas. It was an overreaction, but even the large and conservative British lines, Cunard and White Star, were forced by economic necessity to change with the times. The dramatic drop in immigration to America saw steerage and third-class quarters dropped from most ships and improved to tourist class or tourist cabin. Cheap tickets to Europe attracted a growing number of ordinary middle-class Americans, teachers, students, and office workers. For some, it was a chance to visit the historic sites of the old world. For others, It was a nightlife they'd heard so much about from the Doughboys when on leave in Paris. Despite the growth in tourism, many of the superliners were still far less profitable than in the days of mass immigration to America. Built pre-war, they were now becoming expensive to run and maintain. All the lines operating on the North Atlantic were forced to rethink their strategy. Both White Star and Cunard decided to rebuild their fleets with more modest-sized ships. At 20,000 rather than 60,000 tons, they would be easier to fill and far more economic to run. The German lines were also rebuilding their fleets with smaller vessels. With ships like the 20,000-ton Albert Ballon, Hamburg America was on its way to becoming the largest and most profitable line of the decade. But in 1927, just as the days of the large, high-speed luxury liner appeared to be numbered, the French line launched a stunning new flagship, the Île-de-France. At over 43,000 tons, she was the largest ship built since the war. The Île-de-France was to bring a new era for the superliner, not for her size or speed, but for her revolutionary interior design. Her designers had created a modern, luxurious, and unique ocean liner style that would take the world by storm.
Decoratively, prior to the First World War, the liners were copying landside establishments. Manor houses, castles, even Moorish, Arabian, Egyptian concoctions. And then suddenly, in 1927, comes a liner that breaks away from it completely, the beginning of Art Deco on the high seas.
The Île-de-France would carry more first-class passengers than any ship afloat. It was primarily Americans who fell under her spell, from movie stars to intellectuals, and a new breed of class-conscious American businessmen cashed in their stocks for a first-class ticket to France, just to be seen in the presence of Europe's social elite.
It was like walking into the fanciest hotel you'd ever been in your life. I can remember coming on deck and seeing as far as the eye could see on this boat deck, all the ship's stewards lined out there with their little pillboxes, hats on, their red and blue jackets, standing inspection like they were the Royal Marines. And they had to pass that inspection. Anybody who didn't have his hair cut, his gloves were dirty, his pants weren't creased, and there wasn't a shine on his shoes, he was immediately sent down below.
The Île-de-France was a floating showcase of the best of everything French, a boulevard at sea, a destination in itself. In John Brennan's classic, The Sway of the Grand Saloon, he wrote, "In those years to come, evenings on the Île-de-France may be remembered for everything and anything, except that they were spent in the middle of the ocean." The ocean was as incidental as the street that runs by a hotel. The ship, as a place, had become a reality. By the late 1920s, an ocean voyage was fast becoming a luxury in which fewer and fewer people could indulge. Economic recession would soon turn to depression with the Wall Street crash. The future of passenger lines was threatened as never before. During this period, a new wave of nationalism was sweeping across Europe. And like the heady pre-war days, rival nations still coveted the prestige of owning one of the world's finest ocean liners as a symbol of their maritime might. In 1928, Edna Mussolini, daughter of the Italian dictator, launched the largest Italian liner built to date. At more than 32,000 tons, the Augustus was the largest diesel-powered liner of her time. Then in 1929, it was Germany that sparked a new superliner race with two 50,000-ton giants, Bremen and Europa.
They were intended to be, from the very beginning, the greatest ships in the world. They introduced streamlining to ocean liners. And the superstructure forward was streamlined, it was rounded, tall, thin stacks like on our older vessels. They had very low stacks which were much too low. They had to be raised later on.
Both Bremen and Europa slashed days off the Mauritania's transatlantic record set two decades earlier. No longer humbled by war, Germany was back in the superliner business, and Britain had lost the blue ribbon to her greatest maritime rival once again. But the British, in the form of Cunard, would not give up the race. In the late 20s, the line approached Glasgow shipbuilders John Brown to design two express liners for a new weekly service to New York.
The chairman at that time was adamant that there was no notion of building either the biggest ship or the fastest ship. All he wanted was a ship that would satisfy this requirement for a two-ship service.
Despite Cunard's proposal, the shipbuilders soon realized that to achieve a weekly schedule with only two vessels, the liners would need to be bigger and faster than ever before. These liners would have to be giants. In late December 1930, construction began on the first of the yet unnamed vessels. Hull 534, as she was known, captured the imagination of the British people. At 80,000 tons, she was to be the largest ship ever built, and certainly the fastest. But at the same time, across the English Channel, the French were building a liner of almost equal size and potential speed, the Normandy. She would hopefully follow in the wake of the stunning success of the Île-de-France. The French and the British were now locked in an extraordinary race to be the first to challenge their German rivals for the blue ribbon of the Atlantic. 12 months later, Britain's worsening economy forced Cunard to halt construction of their ship. Over 3,500 men were laid off. And Hull 534, 80% complete, was left to rust. Britain was out of the race. Italian shipping lines were also facing ruin. But in 1932, Benito Mussolini stepped in and forced the merger of his country's three largest lines to form the megalithic Italia line. Within the first year, Italia would launch two brilliant superliners into transatlantic service. The first, the 50,000-ton Rex. She was a greyhound. Her designers were far more concerned with mechanics than luxurious interiors. Averaging 28 knots across the Atlantic, Rex beat out her German competitor's best time to New York by almost 4 hours. She became the first Italian liner to win the coveted blue ribbon of the Atlantic. Her running mate, Conte di Savoia, was fast but not a record breaker. She was fitted with stabilizing systems in a failed effort to combat the eternal problem of seasickness. Then, in late October 1932, the French delivered to an expectant world their most dazzling creation, Normandy. rather than competitor, Normandy would acquire the mantle as the first 80,000-ton liner. And at over 1,000 feet in length, she was the longest ever constructed.